नमस्ते, माई सेल्फ भवानी पेंटेला, वर्किंग एज एन असिस्टेंट प्रोफेसर इन नोएडा इंस्टीट्यूट ऑफ इंजीनियरिंग एंड टेक्नोलॉजी. सो इन दिस लेक्चर आई एम गोइंग टू डिस्कस अबाउट ड्रग्स यूज्ड इन मैनेजमेंट ऑफ सीओपीडी, नेजल डीकंजेस्टेंस एंड रेस्पिरेटरी स्टिमुलेंट्स. इन प्रीवियस क्लास वी हैड कवर्ड अबाउट एक्सपेक्टोरेंट्स एंड एंटी टर्स्क्यूज. सो हियर वी हैड डिस्कस इन प्रीवियस क्लास वी हैड डिस्कस वॉट इज एन एक्सपेक्टोरेंट, वॉट इज एन एंटी टर्स्क्यूज. सो वॉट आर द ड्रग्स कम्स अंडर एक्सपेक्टोरेंट्स? ब्रोंकियल सेक्रेशन एनहांसर्स, म्यूकोलाइटिक्स. एंड वॉट ड्रग्स कम्स अंडर एंटी टर्स्क्यूज? ओपियॉइड्स, नॉन ओपियॉइड्स, एंटी हिस्टामाइन्स. एंड फाइनली वी हैड डिस्कस्ड अबाउट द ब्रोंकियल डायलेटर्स. सो इन प्रीवियस क्लास वी हैड कंप्लीटेड द एक्सपेक्टोरेंट्स एंड एंटी टर्स्क्यूज. इन दिस क्लास वी विल डिस्कस about the management of COPD, nasal decongestants and respiratory stimulants. Okay, without any further delay, we will dive into the class. So, what is any COPD? COPD, the name COPD. COPD is any. So, COPD, what is any COPD? What is the COPD stands for? COPD stands for chronic obstructive pulmonary disorder. So what is any COPD? COPD is any chronic obstructive pulmonary disorder. So which type of disorder it is? It is any chronic disorder which is related to the respiratory system. So which type of disorder it is? The bronchial asthma and COPD both are respiratory disorder, both are the chronic disorders which will can see the narrowing of an air tubes which causes the bronchial constriction. But major difference between the asthma and COPD, in asthma we can by giving of drugs we can reverse the air obstruction, but in COPD there will be no obstruction, there will be no reversible obstruction. The fully reversible obstruction is not observed on the COPD condition. So what is in a COPD? Chronic obstructive pulmonary disorder. So in this is any lung infection, this is caused due to this is what is the main cause here? What is the main cause of COPD? The one and major cause was smoking. Smoking is one of the major cause for COPD. So why, how can you can treat the COPD? First of all, you have to stop the smoking, because the smoking is in a primary risk factor for chronic obstructive pulmonary disorder. So what is what you here you will see in detail how the COPD is going to happen. Just smoke, not only the smoke, smoke is one of the major cause for the COPD. Apart from smoke, here the pollution also will causes the COPD disorder. These smoke pollutants will causes the chronic inflammation. By this chronic inflammation, bronchial muscle will get constricted. By the constriction of bronchial muscle, what is going to happen here? The airway will get narrowed. So here the airway which is passing through the air or which is passing to the tube will get narrow. If the air tube get narrowed, what is going to happen here? The air flow will get limitation. So finally you can see the COPD, chronic obstructive pulmonary disorder. So chronic obstructive pulmonary disorder is due to because of smoke and pollutants, and smoke and pollutants, these smoke and pollutants will causes the chronic inflammation, and this chronic inflammation will leads to the bronchial constriction, and which will causes the narrowing of an air tube. By narrowing of an air tube, which will causes the airflow limitation, by the airflow limitation finally it will leads to the chronic obstructive pulmonary disorder. So what are the, so these are the, this is any disease characterized by, so this is any disease which is characterized by the tightness of any chest. The tightness of any chest is one of the cause for any COPD, and you can see here cough, wheezing is also one of the cause for COPD. Cough, it means not a cause, it's the symptoms. So if you are talking about the symptoms, the tightness of a chest, breathlessness, so you cannot take the breathing properly. So when you were particular person having COPD, he having shortness of breath, he or she cannot take the breath properly. Okay, the tightening of a chest has been observed, wheezing sounds, and you can see the cough. All these are the symptoms you can observe on COPD patients. And COPD is in a combination of two conditions. So COPD is in a combination of two conditions. What are the two conditions here? Chronic bronchitis plus emphysema. Okay, So these are the two conditions. This is the two conditions of the combination of COPD. COPD is in a combination of two conditions. What are the two conditions that that you can see the combination with the COPD? Chronic bronchitis and emphysema. Emphysema and chronic bronchitis are the two conditions of combination of COPD. And next one, treatment of COPD. So how can you treat the chronic obstructive pulmonary disorder? So what is the treatment here? So here the treatment involved mild COPD treatment, moderate COPD treatment, severe COPD treatment and very severe COPD treatment. Depending upon the condition here, you can treat the drugs or you can give the or you can suggest the drugs according to the condition of any patient. If the particular person having the mild COPD, so if the particular person having the mild COPD, here the drug of choice was bronchodilators. So you can give the bronchodilators for the mild COPD patients. And if the patient having the moderate COPD with regular treatment with one or more bronchodilator will be given on the moderate COPD. Regular treatment. And one or more bronchodilators. So in moderate COPD, what is going to here do you hear regular treatment? You have to give the regular treatment and one or more bronchodilators is preferred in moderate COPD. And what is the severe COPD? In severe COPD is same like that moderate COPD. Here regular treatment will be given, one or more bronchodilators is given. Yeah, apart from that, regular treatment with one or more bronchodilators, here you will give the inhaled corticosteroids. Okay, so what are the drugs you give in the severe COPD? Regular treatment and one or more bronchodilators along inhaled corticosteroids. So inhaled corticosteroids are given in the severe COPD condition rehabilitation, right? And last one is very severe COPD treatment. In very severe COPD treatment, here with regular treatment you will give more bronchodilators. One bronchodilator is not sufficient to treat the very severe COPD condition. So here you will give the more bronchodilators along with inhaled corticosteroids, and sometimes here oxygen therapy is also required, and if the condition was severe we have to go for surgery also. So these are all the treatments for the COPD treatment. So mild, moderate, severe and very severe. Depending upon the condition we have to advise the drug, which type of drugs we have to give here. Rehabilitation is a common we can give in every COPD patient. And next one, COPD drugs. So here we will study about the drugs. What are the drugs that can treat the chronic obstructive pulmonary disorder? So before taking the drugs, first thing you have to keep in your mind, because the smoking is the first cause, it is a risk factor for COPD. First you have to avoid the smoking. Smoking should be avoided because it is a risk factor of COPD. So by avoiding of the smoking, somewhat you can decrease the COPD, but it is not fully reversible. This is the thing you have to remember. The COPD was not fully reversible. So which type of drugs you can treat here, which type of drugs you can give to the COPD patients? Ipratropium and tiotropium bromide are the bronchodilators is the choice of chronic obstructive pulmonary disorder. So ipratropium and tiotropium, these are the drugs, these are the bronchodilators. So ipratropium and tiotropium, which type of drugs it is? It is a bronchodilator drugs. These bronchodilators are the choice of drugs in a COPD. So if you compare with the ipratropium and tiotropium, tiotropium is more effective than ipratropium. What is the reason behind this? Why the tiotropium is more effective than ipratropium? Because tiotropium is an inhaled medication will given once in a day. And when you are going with the tiotropium, when you are giving with the tiotropium, this is a drug which given for a several times in a day. Why you are giving it several times in a day? Because it is a short acting drug. Okay, tiotropium and ipratropium, both are the bronchodilators, both are the drug of choice for COPD, but tiotropium is more effective than ipratropium. The reason behind is tiotropium is an inhaled medication which can advise once in a day, but because of short action of ipratropium, it will given several times per a day. So, it is more effect, tiotropium is more effective than ipratropium. Long acting beta 2 agonist drugs are also advised for the chronic obstructive pulmonary disorder. So, what type of long acting beta 2 agonist drugs are given for the COPD patient? Salmeterol, formeterol, etc. There are a lot of drugs, salmeterol, formeterol, all the drugs will falls under long acting beta 2 agonists, which are used to treat the COPD condition. And next one, combination of any drugs. So, which type of combination you can use? So, before taking of any combination, what is the reason why you are taking the combination of drugs to treat the COPD? Because if any patient is taking a single inhaler bronchodilator, if the single inhaler bronchodilator has been failed, okay, if the single inhaled bronchodilator has been failed, then you can advise or then you can take the combination of any drugs to treat the condition of any COPD. So, what the combination of drugs you can see here? Anticholinergic and beta 2 agonist drugs. Anticholinergic drugs can treat the COPD, beta 2 agonist drugs also can treat the COPD. By taking of these single inhaled drugs, the bronchodilation action, if it has been failed, then you can take in a combination therapy. The combination therapy will helpful to the particular patient who have failed on the single therapy. And next, the combination was albuterol and ipratropium. So, albuterol and ipratropium are having the greater bronchodilation and with the drug alone. So, if you are given, the drug albuterol alone or if you are given the ipratropium alone, the action will be somewhat less and somewhat it will show a less bronchodilation action. But when you had combined these both drugs, one drug will increase the action of another drug and you can see the greater bronchodilation action when you had given in combination. Okay, apart from these drugs, you can give the oral corticosteroids. Oral corticosteroids, you have to advise here the short period of time, only for 1 to 3 weeks. It is also helpful, in some patients of any COPD condition. And next one is high dose of inhaled steroids used in advanced COPD. In advanced COPD, we will advise to give the high dose of inhaled steroids. Why you are giving the high dose of inhaled steroids used in advanced COPD? Here in advanced COPD, which dose you are giving inhaled steroids? High dose. And you can give the oral theophylline drugs. Theophylline is an methylxanthine derivative which having the bronchodilation action. This bronchodilation action of theophylline you can use in the COPD condition also as in a third line drug or adjuvant drug or alternative drug, right? So, these are the drugs. So, before going to the nasal decongestants, let me repeat about a few drugs here. Okay, So, these are the drugs of the COPD. So, lot of drugs. So, what are the drugs you can use here? Ipratropium, tiotropium. So, both drugs are the bronchodilators. So, both drugs are preferred in a COPD condition. Tiotropium is somewhat effective than ipratropium, which I had explained you why, because the tiotropium is more effective than ipratropium. And long acting beta 2 agonist also has been given to the COPD patients. Why long acting beta 2 agonist drugs? The long acting beta 2 agonist drugs will be very much helpful to treat the COPD condition. What are the long acting beta 2 agonist drugs? Salmeterol, formeterol. So, these are the drugs. So, a lot of the apart from that, there are a lot of drugs which falls under the long acting beta 2 agonist drugs. With the bronchodilators, the long acting beta 2 agonist is also in a drug choice in the COPD condition. So, if any particular patient is taking in a single therapy, if the single therapy of a single inhaled bronchodilators has been failed, then the particular person have to take in a combination. So, what the combination will be helpful for a particular person when the single inhaled bronchodilator has been failed? So, you can give the anticholinergics and beta 2 agonist drugs. Anticholinergics and beta 2 agonist drugs are the drugs which will helpful to the patient who have failed in the single therapy. And in a combination, you can give the albuterol and ipratropium. So, albuterol is in a drug which will causes the bronchial dilation. Ipratropium is also a drug which will causes the bronchial dilation. By taking of these drugs in a combination, one drug will affect the another drug. How what effect you can see here? One drug will increases the bronchial dilation action of any another drug. You can see the greater bronchial dilation action with the combination of these drugs when you can taken with the alone. And you can give the oral corticosteroid drugs for a short course, 1 to 3 weeks to treat the COPD patients. You can give the inhaled steroids in a advanced COPD and theophylline. So these are the drugs here on the COPD. So what drugs we had discussed here? Bronchodilators, ipratropium, tiotropium. These two are the bronchodilators. Apart from that bronchodilators, we had using the beta 2 agonist drugs. And after beta 2 agonist drugs, if any drug is therapy, if any drug therapy is falling, if any drug has falling, if any drug, if anyone taking any single therapy, if it has been failed, then you can take the combination of any drug. So combination of any drug will helpful when the single person, when the person will not shown any action on the single therapy. Right, so in a combination you can take. So what combination of drugs you can take? The anticholinergic drugs you can take the combination with, and albuterol with ipratropium you can take in combination. You can take the oral glucocorticoid drugs to treat the COPD conditions. You can take the inhaled steroids to treat the COPD conditions, and you can take the oral theophylline drugs. Oral theophylline is an methyl xanthine derivatives which can treat the severe to moderate of COPD asthma, or you can, it is a drug of choice in asthma as well. But in COPD, the oral theophylline will act as a third line drug or alternative adjuvant drug. And next we'll move to the nasal decongestants. So nasal nose decongestants. So what is any decongestants? Decongestants which will relieve the congestion, right? What is mean by decongestion? Decongestants are the drugs which will relieve the congestion. Nasal decongestants are the drugs which will relieve the nasal congestions. So these are the alpha agonist drugs which on topical application it will produces vasoconstriction in action. So these are the alpha agonist drugs. The nasal decongestants are the drugs which falls under alpha agonist drugs. This is an alpha agonist drugs which upon topical administration. So whenever you had applied this nasal agonist drugs on, when you alpha agonist drugs on a nasal, on topically it will produces the local constriction. So there are some imidazole compounds which will comes under the nasal decongestants like nefazoline, xylometazoline and oxymetazoline. So what are the three drugs here? Nefazoline, xylometazoline and oxymetazoline. All these three are the imidazole compounds, the nefazoline, xylometazoline and oxymetazoline. Okay, nefazoline, xylometazoline and oxymetazoline will falls under imidazole compounds. These are the drugs having the longer duration of action compared to that of ephedrine. Ephedrine having the shorter duration of action, but these three drugs, imidazoline compounds, nefazoline, xylometazoline and oxymetazoline, all these three drugs having long duration of action, right? So if you are taking these drugs, it will shows its action about 2-12 hours after congestion is claimed to be less than that of with ephedrine. So if you see in after congestion is claimed to be very much less that with of ephedrine and phenylephrine. And these are the drugs which falls under nasal decongestants. So what are the drugs you see here? Phenylephrine, nefazoline, xylometazoline, pseudoephedrine, oxymetazoline, phenylpropanolamine, also shortly called PPA, phenylpropanolamine is shortly called as PPA. So these are all the drugs falls under nasal decongestants. So what are the nasal decongestants here? Phenylephrine, nefazoline, xylometazoline, pseudoephedrine, oxymetazoline and phenylpropanolamine. All these are the drugs falls under nasal decongestants. So I am giving the stars here, the nefazoline, okay, and xylometazoline and oxymetazoline. So these are the drugs which are the imidazoline compounds which having the longer duration of action compared to that of an ephedrine, okay. So here the drugs like phenylephrine, pseudoephedrine and phenylpropanolamine, the all the starting letters with P, phenylephrine, pseudoephedrine and phenylpropanolamine. So these all the drugs which having, which are given orally but which will constrict the vessel, it having the constriction of an vessel, it will by constriction of these blood vessels the blood pressure will get increased. So what are the drugs comes under nasal decongestants? Phenylephrine, नेफाजोलिन, ज़ाइलोमिताज़ोलिन, सूडोएफेड्रिन, ऑक्सीमिताज़ोलिन एंड फिनाइल प्रोपालामाइन. अमोंग दिस सिक्स ड्रग्स, फिनाइल एफेराइन, सूडोएफेड्रिन एंड फिनाइल प्रोपानोलामाइन, दिस आर द थ्री ड्रग्स विच हैड गिवन ओरली. दिस आर द थ्री ड्रग्स विच यू हैड गिवन ओरली टू प्रोड्यूसेस द कंस्ट्रिक्शन एक्शन. सो वॉट कंस्ट्रिक्शन एक्शन यू हैड सीन विद द थ्री ड्रग्स, इट विल कंस्ट्रिक्ट द vessel. Which type of vessel? Blood vessel. By constriction of these blood vessels, what is going to happen? It will increases the blood pressure. So while giving these three drugs, you should take caution with the hypertensive patients. So you already the patient having hypertension, or if you are advising these three drugs, so these three drugs will increases the blood pressure, it will make more worsen in a particular patient. And next one is caution with nasal decongestion. So what is it, just in a previous slide I had discussed here. So when you are giving the nasal decongestants, you should be very careful with the hypertensive patients. Why you should be very careful with the hypertensive patients? Because in hypertensive patients already the blood pressure will be increased, and these are the drugs, so sudafedrine or phenylephrine. So these are sudafedrine, phenylephrine, all these are the drugs, PPA. So all these are the drugs which will constrict the blood vessels and will increases the blood pressure. So by giving of these nasal decongestants in the particular hypertensive patient, you should be more conscious. And all these drugs are very much effective, but even in a therapeutic dose also it can constrict the blood vessels and it can raise the blood pressure. And we will move to the next topic, was respiratory stimulants. So what is any respiratory stimulants? Respiratory stimulants are also called as any analeptics. So what is an analeptics? Analeptics are the drugs which will stimulate the respiratory system. So analeptics are a drugs which having the capacity to stimulate the respiration even in a subconscious dose also. So these are the drugs which can stimulate the respiration in a subconvulsive doses. So what the drugs here, if you are talking about the respiratory drugs, it also having the narrow margin of safety. So if you slightly increase in dose, it will causes the toxicity. So while taking these drugs, you have to take very much caution while prescribing these drugs to the particular person. So these are the drugs which will increases, which will stimulate the respiration, and it will stimulate respiration in the subconvulsive doses. In a subconvulsive doses, it will stimulate the respiration in subconvulsive doses, but margin of safety is narrow. Why the margin of safety is narrow? Because of its low therapeutic index. So even if you had slightly increased in dose, just now I had said you, if any drug having the safety is narrow, it mean it having the low therapeutic index. What mean the low therapeutic index? It mean if any drug having the low therapeutic index, it means it is not any safe drug. Is any such a drug 100% safe? No. No drug is 100% safe, but these are such a drugs which having any narrow margin, if you slightly, very slightly increase in a dose, also leads to the toxicity. So in a such a condition, in a such a drugs, you have to take very careful. So if you had slightly increased in the respiratory stimulant dose, what is going to happen? The patient even in coma also, he or she can get the convulsions. Why he or she can getting the convulsions? Because of its safety is narrow, right? So to stimulate the respiration in the subconvulsive doses, they do stimulate the respiration in the subconvulsive doses, but margin of safety is very much narrow because of its safety, and the patient may get convulsions when you had given in coma. So what you can do, so here we are saying about the analeptic drugs having the margin of safety is less, then what you can do, what is the more effective method and safe method to take the respiratory stimulants? So mechanical stimulants or mechanical support will be helpful to the respiration, or any other measures that which can improve the circulation. All these are the categories will be very much effective and safe. Okay, by how you can give the drug therapy effective and safe? By mechanical support and improving the circulation by the any other measurements. And what are the respiratory stimulants? The respiratory stimulants, in which condition you can take the respiratory stimulants? In the hypnotic dose poisoning or acute respiratory insufficiency or apnea in any premature infant or any person having any person, if any person had given general anesthetic or if in such a condition, if he or she had failure to the ventilate, then in such a conditions you can give the respiratory stimulants. In hypnotic drug poisoning, in acute respiratory insufficiency, apnea in premature infants, and in general anesthetic poison. And this is the drug of choice in a respiratory system. It will promote the excitation of any central neurons. At a low dose also, it is very much effective. It is in a best anti-enteropathic drug. It will false the blood, it fall, falling of blood pressure is also will get riser if any patient is not responding for the theophylline drug. So, you can advise the doxyprom drug by the intravenous infusion. In such a condition, you can treat the apnea in a premature infants. Thank you.